Hey guys, welcome back to my YouTube channel. If you are new here, welcome. My name is Sierra. And before we get into today's video, I just want to say that I 100% stand by my people. I have been doing what I can to contribute to shedding a light on the injustices happening every day to Black people. I have been donating money. I also was a part of a peaceful protest last week, which was an amazing experience. I've never felt so unified with people, and I just felt so emotional with every step and every meal that I did. And it also made me feel hopeful for the future to come. I know everyone isn't down to protest, but there are other ways that you can contribute to the betterness of the Black community. One way you can contribute is, of course, donating money, and I will have Black organizations and the families of Black people who have lost loved ones due to police brutality. I'll have their links down below if you guys would like to donate and would like to contribute that way. But another way that you can contribute is by educating yourself, reading up on Black history, understanding or trying to understand our struggle and the struggle that we still go through to today, and also the systematic racism. I felt that if I was going to put out content, it had to be uplifting content and content that will spread knowledge. So in today's video, I will be emulating stylish Black creatives, mainly from our past. Some of them are living, some of them are not still living, but just were amazing style icons in the Black community. And they also contributed somehow, way or another, their art and their liveliness to elevating and empowering the Black community. So, the first artist whose style I will be emulating today is Nina Simone. Nina Simone was born in 1933 in North Carolina, and she died in 2005. If you're unfamiliar with Nina Simone, she was a singer-songwriter. She also was a pianist, and she was never afraid to speak her mind and stand up for Black people. One of her quotes was, "As an artist, she felt that it was her duty to reflect the times," and that is exactly what she did through her music. One of her most popular songs is "Mississippi Goddamn," and it was in response to the assassination of Medgar Evers, who was a Black activist and fought for voting rights for Black people and really brought Black people together. He was a pillar in the Black community. The song was also in response to the bombing in Birmingham, Alabama that killed 4 little Black girls. Nina was fearless and was never afraid to express herself. Her style was so graceful, and she really favored really big sunglasses, matching sets, head wraps, and she really liked to wear white gowns because she really felt that it complemented her really dark skin. And I would agree. I feel like when dark skin people wear white, it's like you're glowing, like so beautiful. So the look that I chose that was inspired by Miss Nina Simone is this monochromatic all Black look. I am wearing a head wrap, which, as I told you guys, Nina loved hair wraps. And when I had hair, I used to always wear hair wraps, especially on bad hair days. And I used to really love to wear hair wraps because it really just brings out my features and just really pulls your face up. And I wonder if that's the same reason why maybe Nina Simone loved head wraps. I just chose to wear this Black dress because it matches the head wrap. And like I said, Nina Simone was known for wearing matchy sets. Chose to wear earrings because she loved accessories, she loved dangly earrings, and I feel like I captured her well with this look and also made it my own. You guys, getting into Flo Kennedy. Flo Kennedy was born in 1916 in Kansas. She died in 2000. And if you're unfamiliar with Flo Kennedy, she was an activist, she was a lawyer, she was a feminist. She stood up against racism and sexism. She actually was the second Black woman to graduate from Columbia Law. Flo Kennedy was known as the biggest, the loudest, and the most indisputable. And her style, you guys, was just as loud and boisterous as she was. One of her signatures was actually a cowboy hat. She was always seen with a cowboy hat. And Flo also loved accessorizing. This is one of my favorite pictures of her here with all of the chains and also the head jewelry. It's very beautiful that she would wear. Flo Kennedy was also a fan of luxury brands. You can see her wearing little Louis Vuitton crossbodies and little fanny packs in a couple different photos. The look that I have today that emulates Flo Kennedy's style is this look here. And I don't own any cowboy hats, you guys. I really tried to search deep in my closet for any like cowgirl wear, and I really don't have anything that fits that vibe. So this is really my spin on this look, just my way, my version. Nextly, you guys, getting into the very beautiful, talented, graceful Cicely Tyson. Cicely Tyson was born in New York, Harlem in 1924. She was, and actually still is today at like 95 years old, I believe, a model and actress. Cicely Tyson was really big on in her earlier days, and I would say still today with the roles that she has, but she was really big on only portraying black women in a positive light with the jobs that she accepted. So actually in the beginning of her career, she was not receiving many jobs, and she didn't really have any steady work until the 70s, and she had a big boom. And she was also one of the first black females to really promote natural hair and showing how beautiful natural hair is and different ways you can braid it and wear your fro and be confident in your fro. I was watching one of her interviews, and she was saying how people that worked at hair salons was getting angry because people was coming in like, I want my hair like this. And it was like Cicely Tyson and like a braid do. She was also married to the eccentric and very talented Miles Davis. She was married to him from 1981 to 1988. And we're actually gonna get into Miles Davis a little bit later. I also chose to emulate his style as well. Every time they were out, she looked just as good as him, or if not better. Most of the times better, because she was just so beautiful. And this is one of my favorite pictures of them actually, with the fur coats and her hair just pushed back. It has just given me such luxe blackness and just obsessed. It's a whole vibe. Like, I can't wait to be this. So for Cicely Tyson, I chose to emulate this look in particular because I absolutely love this look. I love the very simple fitted slip dress that she's wearing and just a very statement earring, and like that's the only accessory that she chose to wear. I feel like that's really my style too. Like, I don't really wear accessories a lot, but when I do wear accessories, it's either earrings, nothing else, necklace, nothing else. So my spin is this chocolate brown slip dress that I actually got from Zara. And I chose to wear it with my chunky silver earrings because I feel like it is also a statement with this dress, like Cicely's earrings were a statement. And yeah, I feel really graceful and I feel really elegant in this look. Probably how Cicely felt in that look, especially with her man also looking good. I also love too that she has short hair in this picture, so I don't have any hair, so I feel like it really worked. And that was my look. I had to get in a chair, y'all. My damn legs fell asleep sitting on the floor. The next black creative that we're gonna be talking about today is Eartha Kitt. And Eartha Kitt believes that she was born in 1927 in either South Carolina or North Carolina. She doesn't really know where she was born because she was adopted and her family, I think her mom sold her off. She has a very interesting story and beginning, and I would highly recommend looking at her interviews or reading. Eartha Kitt was a singer, actress, dancer, songwriter. She did it all, y'all. And all of her talents, she forced herself to do it to perfection. She also worked with several youth groups around the world. And one popular altercation that Eartha Kitt is really known for is her visit to the White House. And during this visit to the White House, she chose to speak up against the Vietnam War. So she was at this fancy luncheon with Lyndon B. Johnson, who was the president at the time, and First Lady Johnson. And Eartha Kitt was just like, we need to talk about the matters at hand. She was like, everybody is trying to act like nothing is going on here right now. I believe that one of the topics that they were talking about was juvenile delinquency. And I just want to read a quote what Eartha Kitt had to say about that. She was quoted saying, "You send the best of this country off to be shot and maimed. They rebel in the street. They will take pots and they will get high. They don't want to go to school because they're going to be snatched off from their mothers to be shot in Vietnam." She was also more aligned with the less violent way of protesting and fighting for the justice of black people. I was watching one of her interviews and she did say that she was definitely more so a part of what Martin Luther King was doing during that time. As I said, she was always so graceful and elegant with whatever she did, whatever she wore, y'all. Like, in this picture, she's just wearing a bath towel, but look at how good she looks, and just how feminine and strong and elegant she looks, and poised. She always evoked this really strong feminine energy. And as I was looking through pictures of Eartha Kitt, this picture in particular really caught my eye, because it looks like she was really caught in the moment and she was just enjoying a hot summer day, riding a bike, and someone happened to capture her. My spin is this silk top that you guys have seen so much on my channel. You already know I thrifted it. Actually, this whole look is thrifted, and she was wearing this really nice cream top, it looks like, or white top in the picture, but I don't have anything like that, so I just chose to go with this silk top, and I did my little crossover method to give it that really blousey effect. And I just paired it with my denim shorts that I thrifted, because she was wearing denim shorts in the picture. I love the soft elegance that the pearls bring to this look. I don't own any pearls, but I do have this one necklace. It's the only necklace that I have. I'm actually trying to build my jewelry collection. Don't make fun of me, y'all, but I got this necklace like last summer, and it is a knockoff of the Celine letter necklaces, but I couldn't afford one then, and I can't afford one now, and they're also not available anymore, but I still have this fake one from eBay. I think it was like $20, and this is the necklace that I chose for this look. Last but not least, you guys, I wanted to get a man in the mix, and I thought to do none other than Miles Davis, because I feel like he is the innovator of a lot of men's styles that we see today. Miles Davis was born in 1926 in Illinois, which is also where I am from, so I definitely feel a connection with him. He did, however, die in 1991. I'm pretty sure Miles Davis' name may ring a lot of bells in a lot of people's ears, because if you're not a fan yourself, I'm pretty sure your parents are a fan or your grandparents are a fan. He is known to be the best trumpet player of all time. He was also a composer and a band leader. One of his most known albums is A Kind of Blue, which is actually known to be the best jazz album of all time. One of the most popular songs on there is So What. It's no lyrics to it, but I feel like the you can hear it. So What. Listen to it and tell me what if y'all can hear it, because I feel like you can hear the So What in the instruments. Miles Davis played at galas and black functions for free, and he donated all of the proceeds to black organizations. In terms of his style, he was one of the first to really wear Japanese designers in the States. He wore a lot of Izzy Miyake and this other Japanese designer that I'll have linked here that I was unfamiliar with, but he used to wear a lot of. He was also in support of black designers. He wore a lot of Stephen Burrows, who was a black designer from New York City, mostly known for his real colorful garments. And Miles Davis loved his like suede pants he would wear. Miles Davis style, you guys, he really moved with the times, but he put his own spin on it. And if you really look at some of his looks from the past, you really see some designers chose inspirations from his looks. For instance, this one picture here with where he's wearing this like full-on denim suit and the blue glasses. I mean, that's just totally Gucci right there. As I was looking through Miles Davis' past looks, you guys, I was moved by so many of them. He had so many amazing pieces in his wardrobe. He wore a lot of kimono style pieces. He loved showing off his figure. Everything that he wore, he just wore so confidently. He was really known to wear the clothes and not let the clothes wear him. So the look that I chose to pull inspiration from for this look was this look here. Even with him wearing a very simple shirt like this, he just still had this presence about him that you couldn't help but pay attention to. And I love it because of the shirt that he is wearing. You guys know that I love a mandarin neck, and I actually own a lot of tops with this neckline. And this top in particular is from, what is that damn store called? Wait, it's coming to me. I actually got this shirt from the Japanese store Kai D. I couldn't really tell what he was wearing on the bottom, but I know Miles Davis loved really flowy pants and wide leg pants. He loved anything with like movement. All right, you guys, so that actually sums up this video. Those are some of the black artists, creatives whose style I really admire. And I'm totally down to do a part two to this video if you guys want to see it. Let me know down in the comments. You can also let me know by giving this video a thumbs up. And I will see you guys in my next video. Peace.